सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहैः। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। हरि ओम। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। हरि ओम। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचाणूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं। ओके, सो वी फिनिश वर्स 67 ऑफ भगवद गीता एंड इन द लास्ट 10 वर्सेस Krishna Bhagavan in detail talked about the sense organs, the power of them, how to control them, what are the problems that can happen while controlling the whole science and art of sense organs. And he also mentioned, you know, if forcefully you control them, what can happen? If they are left without check, then that ladder of fall was there, that how, you know, pranashyati will get destroyed, you know, not be able to do any higher stuff. And then it also talked about, he talked about the mind, body, intellect, the connection of sense organs with them. And that whole chariot thing that we did, that they are all connected with each other. Because if we don't understand the whole mechanics of it, it will be very hard for us to control the senses. But if we know everything, like Krishna Bhagavan explained, we have better chance. And then he also said that you have to have a higher goal in life. If you don't have a higher goal, you won't be able to control the senses. They'll go right back. So that's where, you know, this self-realization as a higher goal will, it'll become a lot easier to control the senses. So now, keeping that whole thing in mind, so you cannot forget, when we are going forward, we have to remember all these things. And that brings me to the topic of, hey, everybody should have a book, because if you don't have a book, we can't refer back, because whatever we are doing here is like a tip of the iceberg in this class, because Bhagavad Gita is something you have to read it 50 times. So you have to continue those studies at home, because there's so much in it that in the beginning, we don't grasp everything. But as we go, you will see that every time you will read, it will sink in more and more and more. So there was a big discussion about, you know, paying me for this class. I don't care at all. Instead, you should all buy the book. Whoever doesn't have it, that will be a lot more fruitful. That's okay. I just wanted to say that anyway. So here is verse 68. And as I'm going to chant, you will see that the second line of this verse is a repetition. The same exact line is in verse 58, where he talked about that the kurma, the tortoise, that when he gave an example that how tortoise can withdraw his senses, and he's saying the person who has withdrawn his senses, he is the one who is established in the higher. So that same line is repeated, and the logic here is, Krishna Bhagavan started a thought process. He told the whole science and art of it. And now he's saying, that's therefore you should do this. So it's like, kisi ko bolo na ki tum aisa karo, waisa karo. Lekin uske piche logic nahi do, to koi fayda nahi hoega, koi nahi sunega tumhara. So Krishna Bhagavan was telling Arjun, because Arjun is very logical, just like us. You know, and he's like, you know, has to deal with a sansaric thing every day. So he wants to know exactly in detail. So Krishna Bhagavan told him everything in detail. So here is verse 68. Let's chant it. Tasma dasya mahabaho, tasma dasya mahabaho, nigruhitani sarvashaha, nigruhitani sarvashaha, indriyanindriyarthebhyah, इंद्रियाणिन्द्रियार्थेभ्यः तस्य प्रज्ञा प्रतिष्ठिता, तस्य प्रज्ञा प्रतिष्ठिता सो नाउ तस्मात् इज देयरफॉर यस्य इज हू महाबाहो ओ माइटी आर्म्ड निगृहितानि रिस्ट्रेन दिस इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट वर्ड हियर निगृहितानि मीन्स द वन हु हैज अ कंट्रोल रिस्ट्रेन हु इज अ मास्टर ऑफ whichever way you want to see is that's the word here and here he's calling in Mahabaho oh mighty armed because he's telling Arjuna there's a lot of psychology in what Krishna Bhagwan addresses him at in which verse because he's calling him Mahabaho oh mighty armed means a very great warrior so he's telling him look you may be a great warrior outside you can fight the war and win the enemy but if you're not going to win the enemy inside your mind everything is useless so he's saying that the person who is like strong armed it's like he's referring to internal world now which is applies to all of us so those are the thing and then sarvashah is completely so he's not talking about partial control of the senses the senses have to be fully in the control just like on the chariot the horses have to be fully under control for you to go somewhere and you know like somewhere swamiji Chinmayananji was explaining this concept of the chariot and he said in Krishna Bhagwan days that was a vehicle now we have cars so you can call it steering wheel you know so the steering wheel is like a mind it has to be under control because if it's not go here and there so it's the same analogy you can take anything so sarvasha completely indriyani we know now it is senses the five senses indriyarthebhyah from the sense objects because these indriyas you know they run after the sense objects so we should have a control when it should see what it should see and it should not get affected by them Tasya is his, Pragnya is knowledge, Pratishtita. Pratishtita is that Hindi mein bolte na pratishtit kar diya kisi ko. Usko bitha diya wahan pe. So basically steady means our mind is in that higher self has become steady and therefore your indriyas are all under control. So as I was telling you, you have to catch it from both sides, then you have a better chance of it happening. So, anything else that is okay so one example that is not in here but I thought I'll mention it because it's I think it was very nice example that one of the other swamis gave two examples he gave actually of this India control and after I tell you then we'll go read this so one example he said was about our house that we all have in America especially we have these big homes and then if we stand in our balconies we can hear all the noise and you know if you are established in the balcony then it's very disturbing right and then if we get disturbed by the noise and no I don't want to hear all this so you go inside the house and you go in one of the rooms and it's still bothering you and then you go a little bit internal room and you shut all the door and you sit there if you want to do some serious thing so that's where it's called pratishthita in higher self in a sense that you have withdrawn yourself and you are sitting on the seat of Atma. So I like that analogy a lot because in this analogy he was explaining that there are people sitting at different places. In a sense, if you are sitting in your senses, big problem. If you are sitting in your mind, still there is a problem because you are going swayed by the emotions. And if you are sitting in the wrong buddhi, you know where you are justifying things that you just like to do and you don't want to listen to any higher things then again there is a problem you're establishing the wrong thing you know kind of corrupted buddhi you can call it or wrong understanding and then but if you're sitting in the atma everything is great because that higher self from that perspective you are establishing that so I thought that example was really good one And then the second example he gave was a very excellent one was of the lighthouse. That because he in previous verses he used the word if your indriyas are not under control, they are like a boat which is in the ocean, which is has no direction. The boatman is sleeping or dead or whatever you want to call it. And so it's going here and there, and it's just getting destroyed by the winds and all that, and has no goal. But if you're sitting in the lighthouse, then you are sitting on firm grounds. So lighthouse is attached to that firm ground, and therefore you're not going up and down, and you have a control of yourself. And that lighthouse is on that firm ground, which is the earth, the main earth. Usi ke upar ocean hai. I thought that analogy was very beautiful too, because you are at a stage where the whole sansar is in that. So you are holding on to that real substratum, you know, and that's why you are not, you are totally firm. I thought those two were absolutely beautiful examples. You guys connected to that example, both of them?
Okay. Yes.
Any question on these examples? Because I think that if you understood this, then we got it made. Like, we know what Krishna Bhagavan is talking about. Okay. So now we can read. Who did not read last week and wishes to read? Anyone? Niluji, you want to read?
Sure. Therefore, O mighty armed, his knowledge is steady, whose senses are completely restrained from sense objects.
So this is the conclusion he did, and you know why he did the conclusion. He already talked about everything, and then again he repeated, because to him, you know, this indication is very important. So if our senses are not under control, then we should study those 10 verses and we should try to go on that path to control it. So this is an important thing. That's why he's repeating it. Okay, go ahead.
It is natural, one conversation, that we do not directly give our wise conclusions upon the do's and don'ts of life without giving the logic of our thoughts that is leading to our conclusions. Without preparing our friend's mind to perceive the logic of these conclusions, we dare not declare to him any truth. However, divinely acceptable the declarations are. This principle is most faithfully followed, especially when we want our friend to follow exactly our advice. Arjuna has been told earlier about all the necessary arguments, and here in the stanza, Krishna reasserts the same proposition. Life in self-control alone is life worth living. If we demand from it anything more enduring than tears, sobs, sighs, and groans.
So you see, he gave him the logic that why it is a life of self-control is worth living, because if we don't have it, this is the problem going to happen. That, you know, we'll have tears, sobs, sighs, and groaning. Nobody wants that. So then that's why, therefore, you should have it.
He alone is a man of wisdom, rooted in joy and bliss, who has restrained completely all his senses from their wild roamings all around among their sense objects. Here Arjuna is addressed as mighty armed, which in itself includes a suggestion that however great a hero he might be, in the outer battle with arms against the heroic kings and chieftains of his age, he cannot be considered a real hero until he is able to fight against all his enemies within and win for himself a perfect mastery over the within. He is a hero, mighty armed, and therefore the suggestion is that he can and must try to win over his inner enemies who plunder his wealth of joy and success in the kingdom of heaven within.
So here we already discussed that why he's calling him mighty armed, and the internal battle is a lot more important. Okay.
By restraining the sense organs, which are roaming in the sense objects, does not mean that a man of self-development should destroy his capacities for perception of the world outside, nor does it mean that he is the one who has been rendered incapable of enjoying life. Sense, debility, incapacity is not a sign of better knowledge. It is only meant here that the sense objects filtering through the five archways of knowledge will not, in a perfect man, flood his mind to bring chaos and destruction of his established inner peace and tranquility.
Okay, now this is a very, very important paragraph because people misunderstand the sense control completely. He's not saying ki sense control means sab kuch band karke baith jao aur sara time meditation mein better ho. That's not what he's saying at all. He's talking about that through understanding, you have a control in the senses that while you are moving about in the world and all the information is bombarded to you and constantly coming to you and you are transacting your business, it does not create chaos in your mind. So through all that sadhana, you should be able to handle in the very, very early stages of sadhana. It may be okay to restrain and say, oh, I don't want to eat this or do that or all those things may be okay. But later on, you have to have a mastery over the senses. Because to me, this is a very important thing, because if you misunderstand that, that's when all those vrat ka jo uska roop itta bigad gaya hai, wo uski wajah se bigda hai. Yeah, as though just controlling few food and all that, oh, you have become mastery. But no, that's not true. You know, in fact, the real sadhus, jo bhiksha lete hai na, jo jungle mein ghumte hai wahan pe, unko to jo milta hai, wo khana padta hai. You know, within reason, obviously, they're not going to eat meat and stuff like that. But what I'm saying, they have no choice ki bhai mujhe ye chahiye, wo chahiye, ye sattvic food hai, ye tamasic food hai, wo. They just take everything. But अगर उनको कोई राजसी भोग भी दे देगा तो वो खा लेंगे, और कुछ उनको यू नो एकदम पतली वाली दाल और चावल दे देंगे तो भी वो उतना ही प्रेम से खा लेंगे. सो यू सी व्हाट आई एम ट्राइंग टू से, सो वी हैव टू कीप दिस इन भगवद गीता. दैट इज़ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी हैव टू होलिस्टिकली लुक एट दिस सेंस कंट्रोल एंड डोंट टेक इट फ्रॉम वन एंगल, बिकॉज देन इट डिफीट्स द पर्पस कम्प्लीटली, यू नो. सो दैट्स व्हाई ही इज़ सेइंग दैट डोंट मिसअंडरस्टैंड कि ओ ये मैं देखूँ ही ना, ये मैं करूँ ही ना. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about internal control. Okay.
The ordinary individual in his egocentric existence becomes victimized by the sense organs, while he who has conquered the ego and has transcended his matter identifications comes to live in freedom and perfect control over the clinical sense organs.
Yeah, tyrannical. You know, they create tyranny in, or tyranny, I don't know how to pronounce that, you know, sense organs. So this is a difference that, you know, what is the difference between a realized soul and ordinary person is that we get victimized by our sense organs, and they have a complete mastery because they look at themselves as a separate from sense organs. I don't know why I keep saying sense control. They look at themselves different from sense organs. So they have this, and that's why they're sitting on the lighthouse. So from the worldly perspective, sometimes it may look like they are indulging to us, okay? But actually they are not. From inside, they are not indulging at all. It doesn't make a difference to them. And some people criticize, you know, that, oh, वो स्वामी को तो सब मिठाई दिया, उसने तो सारी खा लिया, यू नो ही इज नॉट डूइंग एनीथिंग. नो दैट्स नॉट वेयर ही इज. इफ यू गिव हिम समथिंग ऑर्डिनरी ही विल ईट, इफ यू गिव हिम मिठाई ही विल ईट दैट टू. ही वांट ही इज नॉट गोना लुक एट, बट वी आर द वन हु हैव दिस यू नो लाइक्स एंड डिसलाइक्स एंड ऑल दिस प्रॉब्लम्स. सो विद दैट आई थिंक दिस वर्स इज काइंड ऑफ रिलेटिवली सिंपल आफ्टर व्हाट वी डिड बिफोर. देयर इज अ बिग बैकग्राउंड बिहाइंड इट. But anybody has any comment, question? No? Shall we go forward? You guys can little bit shake your head like this or something. Otherwise, I don't know what is happening.
Sure.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Good. Looks like, you know, that we all got it. Okay, the next one is very mystical verse, and we'll see why. यानिशा सर्वभूतानां यानिशा सर्वभूतानां तस्यां जाग्रति संयमी तस्यां जाग्रति संयमी तस्यां जाग्रति भूतानि तस्यां जाग्रति भूतानि सानिशा पश्यतो मुनेः सानिशा पश्यतो मुनेः। I just wanted to tell you that I have just muted everybody because your background noise was coming. But anytime you want to talk, just unmute or you can raise your hand or something and we'll know you want to talk. Okay, here, Neelu ji ka phir bhi. Okay. So, in this, let me tell you a little bit about this verse because this is what he's Krishna Bhagwan is saying. Actually, I also like examples a lot because with a certain example, the concept gets into your head much, much nicer than you just talk about the concept. So he has used a very poetic example. And basically he's saying, I think Hindi mein it will sound even better, that jo ye mahatma logon ke liye raat hai, wo hamare liye din hai, aur jo hamare liye din hai, wo unke liye raat hai. Matlab hamara dimag ekdam ulta hai. Or I will tell you why he's saying this. So, you know, if you think about it, word meaning, we don't get much out of it. What does it mean? I mean, you know, some people in a very extreme cases, they will say, oh, they are all awake at night. That's not what it means.
We miss Sanskrit to Hindi translation.
What's that?
We miss that.
Yeah. I haven't come to that. I was just explaining and then we will go to that. Maybe I'll do the words and then maybe some words might have a little more deep. So ya is which, nisha is night. Sarva bhutana of all beings. Tasyam in that, jagrati is wakes. Sanyami, the self-controlled. Yasyam in which, jagrati is wake, bhutani all beings. Sa is that, nisha is night again, pashyatah seeing, muneh of the muni. So yahan muni mitlab mananshil, the one who is like self-realized, established, you know, who has a higher thinking capacity. So coming back to that example, darkness is symbolizes ignorance in Vedanta. Whenever we say, you know, darkness of ignorance, we call it tamas, you know, and all that. So what he's saying is the ordinary human beings, they are not awake to that higher state, that Turiya state bolo, or the highest self-realized state. That's why we are in darkness. So when he says about darkness of ignorance, we have to separate this from the worldly knowledge part of it, okay? In the world, you may be PhD and you may be like, know everything about science and art and you call it psychology and you may be the biggest pundit. But if you are not awake to that higher reality, that's what is called ignorance in Vedanta. So you are in darkness according to Vedanta. So it has absolutely nothing to do with the worldly knowledge here. So he's saying that the people, unke liye wo jo state hai na, darkness hai, night hai, unko kuch dikhai nahi deta wahan pe. To jab ordinary logon ko nahi dikhai deta hai, usme wo jaga hua hai. Usko wo din dikhai deta hai because he can see that state. He can be in the turiya, okay? And now look at it opposite way. Jo hamare liye din hai na, wo uske liye raat hai, wo bol rahe hain. Because hamare liye din kya hai? हम लोग जो ये ट्रांजैक्शन करते हैं ना व्यावहारिक, वो हम लोग असली समझते हैं, राइट? ओ माय गॉड, ये हो गया, वो हो गया, व्हाटएवर, वी आर यू नो ट्रांजैक्टिंग. ट्रांजैक्शन इज फाइन, देयर इज नो प्रॉब्लम इन ट्रांजैक्शन, बट वी फॉरगेट दैट इट इज लाइक अ ड्रीम, दैट आई एम नॉट दिस रियल वन. आई हैव कम हियर टेम्पररली टू मे बी लर्न सम लेसन और यू नो इंक्रीज माई वाइब्रेशन, व्हाटएवर यू वांट टू कॉल इट. सो वी थिंक दिस इज द रियल वर्ल्ड एंड दे नो दैट इट इज अ ड्रीम वर्ल्ड, इट्स अ स्लीपिंग स्टेट फॉर देम. Nothing, not much. Do you see the connection now? What he's saying about that opposite hai. So keep that in mind and then we can go further. And one more very good example that this other Swamiji gave from Chinmaya Mission. He said that we have discussed this rope and snake ka example very well, right? Everybody knows that example of rope and snake. Ek rope padi hui hai, lekin wo andhakar hai, to partial light hai, to wo mujhe snake dikhai de raha hai. So snake dikhai de raha hai, to mujhe pata hi nahi ki wo rope hai. Okay, so I just looking at it as a snake. Now I become a master of snake. I know everything about the snake. You know, I know how it behaves. I know what color it is. I know that how different snakes interact with each other and blah, blah. I have become absolute pandit in it. But I have no clue about the rope. So that's what the kind of analogy to us is, that we live in this world, we do all the hangama here, but we have no clue about the consciousness, about the substratum and all that. So that's why it is like useless, you know. So that example I thought was a very good one. So, and the other thing he kind of joked, he said, you know, in the satsang, whenever people talk about world and work and children and grandchildren, sabhi ke kaan khade ho jayenge, and they say, oh yeah, this is such a good satsang, I learned so many things and all that. They get all excited. Moment they start talking about self and consciousness and all that, you know, many people are not interested in it. You know, but really speaking, that's what they have come here to tell you, you know. So when he's talking about ignorance and knowledge, that's the knowledge they're talking about, is the highest self, because all the shastras, they are like, that's what they're pointing to. They take you through their journey of, you know, karma yoga and everything and all that. But the ultimate goal is to transcend. So he was saying that how this subject is very sublime subject, you know, it's like you have to go to a different paradigm almost, you know. So that's why it's a slow process. It may not happen right away, but if we know that that's what the goal is, you know, that's what we need to strive for. And this example, kind of, Krishna Bhagwan ne sab kuch bol ke, you know, ye example de diya taki this example probably explains it the best way, you know, that what state we should be in. Okay, so keeping that in mind, let's just go further now. Kaun padhna chahta hai? Meena ji, wanna read?
That which is night to all beings, in that the self-controlled man awakes. Where all beings are awake, that is the night for the sage Muni who sees. In order to bring home to Arjuna the idea that the world as experienced by an individual through the goggles of the mind, intellect, body is different from that from what is perceived through the open windows of spirituality, is different from what is perceived through the open windows of spirituality, this stanza is given. The metaphorical language in this verse is so complete in detail that data mongering modern intellect is not capable of entering into its poetic beauty. Of all the people of the world, the Aryans alone are capable of bringing a combination of poetry and science. And when the greatest poet philosopher of the world takes his writing rod to pour out his art of perfection onto the ancient palm leaves to express the bliss of perfection in the ecstasy of his poetry, he could not have used a better medium than the Gita to pour himself out.
So basically, Swamiji is just telling us that how they have brought a poetry into this now. You know, because sometimes, you know, the poets jo hai na, jab bhi wo log poetry bolte hain, to jo badi badi baatein hoti hai, wo poetry ke madhyam se humko bolte hain, to humko ekdam samajh mein aa jati hai. Hum haste haste samajh jate hain. Waise hasya kavi wagar mein, actually, if you think about it, they are great philosophers. Most of these poets see things that we miss out. And then they bring it out and say, wow. So that's what here he's saying, that Aryans were capable of bringing this combination of poetry and science together. But our modern, there's not too much logic, data mongering modern intellect. We know that we get drowned in it, you know. But he's saying that this is the beauty of this, that, you know, the huge concept, and it brought in a very simple poetic manner so that we understand. That's what he's saying.
Here are the two points of view of the ignorant and the wise are contrasted. The ignorant never perceives the world as it is. He always throws his own mental color on the objects and understands the imperfections in his mind to be part and parcel of the objects themselves. When a child is looking out onto the world through the colored panes of the bedroom window, through each glass he sees the world colored in the color of the glass through which he's looking. But the world as such can be seen only when the panel of the window is open. Then with the naked eye, the naked world is seen.
So here Swamiji has told you the exact reason why that happens. That why do we not see the world as it is? Because what we do is we put our mental color on the world, and then we look, oh, ye to kharab hai, wo to kharab hai. That's what we do. You know, we have wearing those, whereas the saint and sages, unhone wo sare chashme utar ke fek diye. You know, they don't have that the way, so they look at world as it is, whereas we look at, and that's why we don't see what it is. Jo hum log ko bola na, hum soye hue hain, kyunki hum log dekh hi nahi rahe hain jaisa hai, hum log apni mental impression ke through dekh rahe hain. So he explained why in this paragraph, why that happens.
The consciousness in us is today capable of recognizing the world only through the media of the body. Naturally, we see the world imperfect, not because the world is ugly, but because of ugliness in the media through which we perceive.
Now you understood, he explained it, that we are seeing the world as ugliness because we have a problem. The world has, kisi ne bola, world mein koi problem nahi hai. If you're seeing from the highest perspective, don't misunderstand. When a vyavarik level, if you have to fix something, but inside you should know that you are just a small instrument, because jisne dunya banayi hai vagara, usko malum hai ki kya hai sab kuch and kyu banaya hai, kya kiya. So we don't need to psychoanalyze that. But if you have put into certain place to do something, by all means do that. But overall, there is a tremendous harmony in the whole universe. That's what he's talking about.
After death experience, as you have said, those people who have come back, they have explained exactly yes. That the world is perfect.
Yes, that's what they say. They said, oh my God, when people get, they themselves had a lot of imperfect lives before they went into that realm by accident, or it was meant to be, I don't know. But most of the people who had that NDE, they were like, they had life-threatening situations, right? So some of them had horrible diseases, some people had horrible accidents. But when they went into the realm, they said, oh my God, that's how it was supposed to be. You know, because so it was like their whole shift changed completely. So when they come back, nothing bothers them. They have no fear of death. They have no fear of anything. They know how, they are sitting on that lighthouse. That's what happened to them there. And some of them, it took them a little while to transition because they could not understand. You know, they had never studied this. They never studied consciousness. They didn't know. But they knew that whatever they said, everybody said basically that was real to them. That was their real home. Most of them didn't want to come back. But then they had some guides to tell them, hey, you need to go back to learn this or to help somebody and things like that. But whatever they are saying here in this language, that they were sitting on that rock or sitting on that, that's what happened to them then, that they realized they were sitting on the rock. And some people came already with that understanding that they are sitting on the rock, you know. So it was quite amazing that how this translated to that,
right?
Yeah.
When an electrical engineer comes to a city, and when at the lightning time the whole city smiles forth with its lights on, he immediately inquires, is it AC or DC current? While the same vision to an illiterate villager is a wondrous sight, and he only explains, I have seen the lights that need no wick or oil. From the standpoint of the villager, there is no electricity and no problem of AC or DC currents. The world, the engineer sees among the very same bulbs is not realized or known by the unperceiving intellect of the villager. Nor is the engineer awake to the world of strange wonderment which the villager enjoys.
So here Swamiji has said another point. He's saying, hum jis duniya mein jeete hai na, wo duniya ye saint and sages ko koi interest nahi, koi kuch samajh mein bhi nahi aate. To kya paglon ki tarah ye log duniya ke piche pade hue, they can't understand us. They have gone to that stage. And you know, we don't understand them. So basically it is like, सब अपनी अपनी दुनिया में खोए हुए हैं, यू नो, और सबको अपनी दुनिया की चीज़ें दिखाई देती हैं. एंड वी नो दैट कोई इंजीनियर कोई चीज़ को देखेगा वो एकदम डिफरेंट ढंग से देखता है, और कोई ऑर्डिनरी देखेगा उसको समझ में नहीं आएगा वो इंजीनियर क्या कर रहा है, यू नो. एंड द इंजीनियर कैन नॉट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाई दिस गाय इज़ नॉट गेटिंग इट व्हाट आई एम सेइंग, यू नो. सो ही ब्रॉट दैट पॉइंट आउट विच इज़ वेरी वैलिड ऑल्सो. दैट्स व्हाट हैपेंस, यू नो, वंस समबडी गोज टू दैट स्टेट.
अ मास्टरमाइंड is he who, rooted in his wisdom, opens up the panes of his perception and looks on at the world with his eye of wisdom.
So this is a very important one, that he sees the world with the eye of wisdom. So it's not like from his worldly eyes, he's seeing the same thing we are seeing. You know, the atrocities, the this thing and all that. But the reason he does not get disturbed, because he knows there is a higher reality. This is just like a leela or play or whatever is happening. He is seeing it from the eyes of wisdom. So when if we are talking about seeing, it's something that internally he's talking about. You know, eye of wisdom rather than these physical eyes.
Intuition, would you call that? Intuition?
Yeah, intuition or a very deep understanding,
higher,
I would call it.
Higher
understanding. It's like the way I will describe it, that the best example for the children, we use this example a lot, that when small children are playing with balloons and a balloon pops, a baby starts crying or a two-year-old starts crying, and the older kids and the other people, they don't care. So we already know balloon is going to pop one day. Why are you crying? You know, that's the difference, that they are rooted in a higher understanding, you know.
Right. Yeah. Here in the stanza, we are told that the egocentric finite mortal is asleep to the world of perception enjoyed and lived by the man of steady wisdom. And the perfect one cannot see and feel the thrills and sobs which the ego gets in his selfish life of finite experience.
So now you understood that how the dono ki duniya alag hai. I think this is what they're talking about. But by knowing that contrast, we should know where our goal is. That, hey, I want to get awakened to this higher reality, because then I will see the harmony, the love, the, you know, everything in the world. I'm going to see that. If I'm not awakened to the higher reality, I'll be always crying, upset. Everything is bad in the world. That's what's going to happen to me. That's what it's telling me.
The Lord proceeds to teach by an illustration that a wise devotee alone, who has abandoned desires and whose wisdom is steady, can attain moksha, and not he who without renouncing cherishes desires.
So basically, you know, he's going to go further into this, and he's going to tell you in the next verse that, you know, how he gave the example of the ocean. Ki ocean mein सारी चीज़ें आ जाती हैं, पानी, पता नहीं कहाँ कहाँ से पानी निकल आके, नदियाँ सारी उसमें मिलती हैं, सब कुछ मिलता है, मगर ओशन रिमेंस अनमूव्ड. एक हिंदी में कहावत है कि ओशन अपनी मर्यादा नहीं छोड़ता है. अगर ओशन ने मर्यादा छोड़ ली ना, तो प्रलय आ जाएगी. वी नो दैट इट हैज़ इट्स ओन बाउंड्री, यू नो. सो बिकॉज ऑफ द पर्सन हु सेल्फ रियलाइज इज लाइक दैट, एवरीथिंग इज पोरिंग इन टू हिम इन द संसार, but he remains unmoved. So we will see that, you know, next time. This got over a little faster, but because I think we had already hashed out so much about sense organs and all that, but I had prepared for two thoroughly, so I will leave it at that, and then we can go to Mandukya. But anybody has any comment, question, anything? Today we have time, so you can say it. Unmute and say it if you want to. This is very unlike other classes. Where we discuss, and we felt like we're not even going forward because we got so many questions. So I think this staying at home, everybody's become very, very reflective now. Nothing? Next time we can do more verses also.
I think both these verses are kind of very clear. And I mean, the first one was clear and easy to understand. And the second one was very difficult to understand, but you explained it wonderfully well. So I think it has become very clear, at least to me. I can speak for myself.
I am so happy, because then whatever class we are doing it, I feel like it's all worth it. If that's how you feel, then. So that's why if you're not understanding something, please let me know, and then I can do the adjustment accordingly. But if you understood, I'm happy, you know. And
yes, that goes with the examples that you gave and the explanations that you gave, I think the second one has also become very, very clear now.
Great.
I'm speaking for myself. Yeah.
Because, you know, when I started studying Bhagavad Gita, that's what I realized, that the things were so deep, and you have to literally, like, sometimes, you know, different swamis have different way of explaining, and if you hear many different versions, then all of a sudden something clicks. Wow, this is really, you know, clicking in my head, because firstly, they are all the mantras and sutras are very small, but there is so much power packed behind it. You need a lot of chintan and all, and then one verse will have so many other things, and that's why the basic knowledge is also very important to know, you know, otherwise it becomes very confusing, you know. If somebody had never heard of consciousness and all that, then they will not understand this, but we have hashed it out so deeply, you know, in this class, that now we know what it is, then it becomes easier. So let's do the prayer together. Om Bhadram Karne Vishnyam Devaha Bhadram Pashye Maksha Bhirya Jatraha Stire Range Sushtu Vagam Sastanubhihi Vyashema Deva Hitam Yadayuhu Swastina Indro Vidashavaha Swastina Pusha Vishvavedaha Swastina Kstaksharyo Arishtanemihi Swastino Bruhaspatir Dadatu. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Hari Om. And the other prayer. Narayanam Padbhuvam Vashishtam Shaktincha Tatputra Parasharamcha Vyasam Shukam Gauda Padam Mahantam Govinda Yogindra Mathasya Shishyam Shri Shankaracharya Mathasya Padma Padam Chahasta Malakancha Shishyam Tamtrota Kamvarti Kakarya Manyan Asmad Gurun Santata Manatosmi Asmad Gurun Santata Manatosmi. So we finished 92, in which he mentioned that all egocentric entities are by their very nature illuminated from the very beginning, and they are ever immutable in their nature. Basically, what he was trying to tell us, we jivas are actually that consciousness. From the very beginning, we are there. He who with this knowledge rests without seeking further knowledge is alone capable of realizing the highest truth. So he was telling us how, when we move towards this knowledge, our mind start becoming calm. Do you remember that in Bhagavad Gita also he said that when you go into the samadhi, your mind becomes calm? That means all of a sudden it's not agitated. Mujhe, oh, what about this? What about that? You know, even seeking knowledge, you kind of stop. And this morning, actually, I saw one program. It was quite amazing program, and the reason I'll tell you why it was amazing, because in the beginning I was watching all this universe program who on the physical level try to understand what universe is. So I watched because our son is interested in that kind of stuff. So both of us were watching a lot. And it was a fascinating program and all about Earth and planets and galaxy and universe and quantum physics. And oh my God, so much science. I may not understand everything, but overall gist I was getting. And then towards the end of watching this program, I told my son, you know, this is completely missing in these guys that, you know, they don't talk about consciousness at all, you know. And then there is one program that I watched this morning. It was on YouTube, and if somebody's interested, Joe might be interested, really. I will send that link, whoever is interested. There is a guy who was, like, interested in physics, but he was very, like, a loner. He didn't connect to the world because he had probably some spiritual bent or something. So he started studying physics on his own. And then now he may have a position. I didn't finish that program because the class was there, so I, you know, stopped it. So I'm going to finish it. But he's the one who linked the two together, you know. And he said that 20 years ago, it was like when I would talk about this, I would get completely booed. Meaning, you know, they wouldn't want to listen to him. He's saying, he called it the C word, the consciousness. He said, you know, in America, you can say the F word as many times as you want, but you cannot say the C word in those days because people, they will boot him out.